Good morning, students. Today we will discuss the solution of a helium atom. I told you in the last class, the helium atom solution, the exact solution of helium atom is extremely difficult, mainly because we have a six variable problem. Therefore, it is very difficult to write down and solve the Schrodinger wave equation. Okay, therefore, that is where the approximation methods have come into the picture. And then other than hydrogen atom, we don't have exact solution of any other atoms. Okay, the next simplest atom after the hydrogen atom is the helium atom. If that is not having any solution, then you imagine the situation of the higher other elements like lithium, beryllium, boron, or maybe uranium. So all these atoms do not have exact solution like the hydrogen atom. Okay, so that is where the approximate methods, the two methods which I have described in the last class, that is the perturbation method and the variation method, have been developed to understand the at least some of the eigenvalues and eigenstates of the atoms. Okay, let us look at the solution very briefly. I mean, what I'm going to give you is a kind of a qualitative picture, not a exact quantitative picture of the helium atom by approximation methods. Okay, so this is the helium atom. So let us start with the Hamiltonian. And in the last class itself, we have discussed about the Hamiltonian. The Hamiltonian will have three kinetic energy terms because we have three particles, nucleus, and then the electron number one and electron number two. And therefore, and then similarly, we have three potential energy terms. This is the, if the electron is interacting with the nucleus, then we have one potential energy term. Well, we have another electron, if that is interacting with the nucleus, that will have a potential energy, that is this quantity. And then at the same time that the electron-electron is also interacting, that is basically a repulsion. Therefore, we have added a positive sign here in the Hamiltonian. Okay, now this is the actual Hamiltonian of the helium atom. Suppose if I ask you helium plus, what would be the Hamiltonian of the helium plus? Writing a Hamiltonian, it should be like a cakewalk by now. So if you want, if you are asked to write down the Hamiltonian of any atom or any ion, then you should be able to write down. By looking at the number of particles in the given atom or the ion, then we can write down the kinetic energy terms. Similarly, we can also write down the interaction energy, that is the potential energy terms also we can write down. Okay, so suppose if you are asked to write down the Hamiltonian of a helium atom, then how it will be different? Well, helium plus will have one electron shortage. Therefore, one kinetic energy will not be there and one potential energy will not be there. So rest of the terms will be there, right? Suppose if I ask you to write down the hydrogen molecular ion, that is the H2 plus. Hydrogen, one hydrogen contains one nucleus, one electron. Okay, but if one electron is knocked out from the molecule, then basically it will have three particles, two nucleus and one electron, right? So therefore, three kinetic energy terms will be there. And then the one electron is interacting with one nucleus, therefore one potential energy term will be there. Similarly, the other electron is also interacting with the other nucleus. So there is another kinetic energy term. And both the nucleus, okay, two hydrogen nucleus, they will also interact. That is, again, it's going to be a repulsion. Therefore, that will have a repulsion term as well. So depending upon the situation, one should be in a position to write down the Hamiltonian for any given system. Okay, whether it is a neutral species or the cation or the anion, you should be in a position to write down. Okay, please practice this part and let us move on, that the helium atom Hamiltonian is given by this. And then suppose if you keep the origin at the nucleus, then the first term, that is this particular term, can be neglected. Okay, then the remaining term will be there. Okay, having the Hamiltonian, then what we should do? Then we actually supposed to do the plug in this Hamiltonian in the Schrodinger wave equation, time independent Schrodinger wave equation, and then try to obtain different equations by separation of variables method. We should try to separate different differential equations, and then if we are able to solve those differential equations, then we'll get the complete solution. But then it is already, I pointed out that it is having six variables. Okay, even if you neglect the nucleus, it contains six variables and extremely difficult. Therefore, we'll proceed by approximate methods. Okay, but before that, let me discuss very small topic, atomic units. This has some relevance because we are each time writing some very lengthy Hamiltonians and also the energy expressions. We can avoid by introducing the atomic units. We can simplify writing some of the terms in the Hamiltonian or in the Schrodinger wave equation, etc. Therefore, let us look at what are the atomic units. Atomic units are actually nothing but the electron. We know what is the mass of the electron. That particular mass of the electron, 9.1 into 10 raised to minus 31 kg, right? So that is the one unit that is taken to be one atomic unit, right? And the charge of the electron, 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulombs. So that is taken to be one unit, okay? Similarly, the H cross, that is H by 2 pi, is taken to be one atomic unit. Similarly, A naught, the first Bohr orbit, that is taken to be one atomic unit. Similarly, 4 pi epsilon naught, 4 pi epsilon naught, again it is taken to be one atomic unit. Similarly, one atomic unit of energy is taken to be 27.2 electron volts. I mean, why all these things are necessary? Well, it is very obvious, the answer is very obvious that okay, we have a 1 kg of vegetables. So we can't use such a huge quantity. Kg is a huge quantity. And we are dealing with the microscopic world, and microscopic particles are there which are having very less weights. So it is appropriate that we should use appropriate scales so that we can get some qualitative as well as quantitative picture to visualize the quantities, whatever the measurable quantities, we can observe it. That is the purpose for introducing these atomic units. Now let us write down the Hamiltonian in terms of the atomic units. So this is the Hamiltonian of the hydrogen atom, and if you recall, and this can be simplified. Well, here if you look at the reduced mass is here, but then reduced mass for hydrogen, it is not so different from the hydrogen atom, so different from the electron mass. Therefore, you can actually keep the electron mass itself, right? So that becomes one according to our atomic unit definition. And then the 4 phi epsilon naught is taken to be one unit. Therefore, you can see that how nicely it is modified. So we need not to write all the time. There is another quantity, h cross square. So h cross itself one, therefore one square means that is one. So h cross square become one, and similarly the denominator, it becomes one, right? Of course, there is a two multiplied by one, it is half, right? So minus half del square. Okay, so I have just removed all these notations, and the hydrogen atom Hamiltonian become much simpler in this particular format. You can see that here e square. What is e square? E square is the charge of the electron, right? One square. So one, and then 4 pi epsilon again taken to be one. Okay, this again taken to be one, and this again taken to be one. Therefore, it is just 1/r. Okay, this modulus of r bar, it is nothing but the position, the magnitude of the position vector, which is nothing but the distance between the electron and the hydrogen nucleus. So the Hamiltonian becomes much simpler in this form. Then what about the wave function? Well, wave function also can be written in the atomic units. Okay, so if you just try to recall the what we have here is the 1s atomic orbital wave function. 1s atomic orbital wave function. Okay, please remember that I might not have given this z, but then in principle the z is also will be there. Why? Because the solution which we discuss in the case under the hydrogen atom description, actually it is also applicable for the heterogeneous atoms. Heterogeneous atom, which what I mean is that which resemble the hydrogen like atoms. Okay, so there are hydrogen helium, so helium plus you can apply that one. Okay, because it has one electron and then one nucleus, so the problem becomes simpler. And the lithium 2 plus, okay, so these are all hydrogen like atoms, okay, but not hydrogen. So in that case, so what is different hydrogen like atoms and the hydrogen is that the charge has to be accounted. So therefore here that one z cube will sit on the numerator. Okay, so that's the difference between the previous one and this one. Of course, if it is a hydrogen atom, the z is equal to 1, therefore this will become a unity. Okay, now this is the actual hydrogen wave function. Now you can actually convert this into atomic units. How you can do that? Well, we know that the z is z itself, but then a naught, the first Bohr orbit, it is taken to be one unit, right? So in atomic units, that is taken to be one unit, that you can actually remove that. Similarly, it is e to the power minus zr by a naught. Okay, originally z was not there. Okay, z was not there, but then if you are applying this to a hydrogen like atom, so here the charge has to be incorporated. Now the wave function in atomic units, hydrogen 1s atomic orbital, it is given by z cube by pi to square root of z cube by pi multiplied by e to the power minus zr. Okay, so that is very simpler. And of course, this you can allow it to operate upon the wave function, suitable wave function, that is nothing but the 1s atomic orbital. I mean, what is the Hamiltonian? Hamiltonian is here. This Hamiltonian, when it operates upon the 1s atomic orbital, we get the eigenvalue. I mean, that is the energy of the 1s atomic orbital, and then we get the function back, isn't it? Now, if you like, you can actually go on and try to calculate or represent the energy of the hydrogen atom, especially for the 1s atomic orbital. The energy can be expressed in terms of the atomic units. Okay, how you can do that? Well, again, the same discussion that I have given the expression like this. I have given the expression like this. So the energy of the hydrogen atom, it is given by mu e to the power 4 divided by 2m square multiplied by 4h cross pi epsilon naught whole square. So that's the expression. But then if you are trying to apply this to a hydrogen like atom, then the charge has to be accounted, then one z square will just sit on the numerator in this particular expression. Okay, now you can actually in this expression you can just all these unit what we have thought of, then the definitions of the atomic units you can incorporate here, and then that becomes very simpler. So this is like minus z square by 2n square. Why? Because mu is nothing but the reduced mass. So in the case of a hydrogen atom, then the reduced mass is not so different. Therefore, normally we can take this reduced mass as the electron mass itself, and then therefore in atomic unit that becomes 1, and then the charge is already taken to be 1, and then h cross is taken to be 1, and then 4 pi epsilon naught is taken to be 1. Therefore the entire quantity becomes much simpler, and then it is a unity. In fact, then what is left over is minus z square upon 2n square, where n is the quantum number. Okay, where n is the quantum number? Well, for the hydrogen atom 1s atomic orbital, the energy is going to be e1, which is equal to just half atomic unit, 0.5 atomic units. Okay, if you like, you can convert this into electron volts and then represent the energy. Right? So let us now write down our helium atom. That is the discussion of today topic. So therefore, let us try to represent the helium atom in atomic units. This is the Hamiltonian. Then the Hamiltonian, you can see that the H cross square, it becomes one. The mass of electron, this becomes one, and this becomes one. And then the charge is becoming one. Okay, 4 pi epsilon becomes one, right? So these are all things become unity, and then finally what we have is a very, very simpler, beautiful equation that we can remember in all the times. Okay, you can see this. This is just half del 1 square minus half del 2 square minus z by r1 minus z by r2 plus 1 by r12. So it is very, very simple and then clean expression to remember this. Well, you can actually calculate even the energy also, right? Energy for the helium atom also. Remember that the charge for the helium atom, it is going to be 2. Z is going to be 2 square divided by 2. That is actually 2 atomic units. You can multiply that atomic units 2 into 27.6, the electron volt, if you convert it, that is the energy of the helium atom. Now, having understood what is the atomic, what are the atomic units, and then how to express the Hamiltonians and the energies of the atomic orbitals, then what we do that we will try to apply the perturbation theory and also the variation method to the helium atom, and then try to see that how the approximate methods are actually helpful in getting the actual energy of the helium atom. Okay, so we will start that. Now, for this, let me take once again the Hamiltonian. Anyway, it is here, the helium atom Hamiltonian in atomic units. It is given by minus half del 1 square minus z by r1 minus half del 2 square minus z by r2 plus 1 over r12. I don't know whether you have noticed or not, the difference between this and this is absolutely, there is no difference, but I have written a slightly different manner, whether you noticed or not. This color, you know, you can see that I have basically rearranged it. This I have taken here, this I have taken the other side, okay, other side of this. Okay, so this, why I have done this, because this actually corresponds to the electron number 1. This del 1 operator corresponds to the electron number 1. Okay, this potential energy term corresponds to electron number 1. Similarly, these two correspond to electron number 2. Please remember that helium atom, we have one nucleus and then two electrons. Then again, we have the repulsion term that I have written as such. Okay, now there is a purpose for which I have written this. Suppose if you just imagine that this particular term is not there. Suppose if this particular term is not there, then what happens to the Hamiltonian of the helium atom? Well, nothing happens. But then if that is not there, physically it means is that, okay, the electron, one electron is moving independently without feeling the presence of the other electron. It means, suppose if there is no inter-electrons, you have two electrons, well, they are actually orbiting. At the same time, they are also interacting. Now, we are saying that the repulsion is not there. Repulsion term, if you remove for the time being, then it means is that the electrons are independently moving. Both are interacting with the nucleus, but they don't interact with each other. Okay, so that is the meaning of removing this. If we remove the electron-electron repulsion term, then the problem becomes much simpler and then very easy to handle. Okay, let us do that. Suppose if you remove the electron-electron repulsion, the solution of the helium atom is going to be much simpler. Let us look at first, okay, the perturbation treatment of the helium atom by considering the fact that we are removing the electron-electron repulsion. So if we remove the electron-electron repulsion, this part, the first half part of the Hamiltonian, it becomes the Hamiltonian of a hydrogen atom. And the other part also becomes the Hamiltonian of the other atom. Okay, Hamiltonian of the other atom. Now, what happened to the solutions? Well, the solutions are quite obvious, right? The solutions are quite obvious. So if you have now two hydrogen atoms, the helium atom problem become the problem of two hydrogen atoms. We know exactly what is the solution of a hydrogen atom. We know exactly what is the solution of hydrogen atom. Suppose if we have in our Hamiltonian, if we have one minus half del square minus z by r, that is the Hamiltonian, precisely the Hamiltonian of the hydrogen atom. If it operates upon sortable wave functions, then we get the eigenvalue and then wave function back. We have seen the solution of hydrogen atom. Similarly, you consider the other atom, other Hamiltonian, two terms, then that is also, when it operates upon sortable wave function, then we get the sortable wave, the eigenvalue and then function back. Now, what I mean to say is that the total wave function in this particular case, it is going to be the product of two wave functions. Now, it is going to be the product of two wave functions. It is not a single wave function, right? Isn't it? So we have two electrons, and then since we have two Hamiltonians of the hydrogen atom, so those are the total wave function is going to be the product of two wave function, and this is, let's say, the capital psi R12. What are the R1 and then R2? These are the position variables that describe the position of the electron number one as well as the electron number two. Okay, so the total wave function can be taken as the product of two wave functions, such that the one wave function exclusively depend upon the position where coordinates of the one electron, whereas the other wave function depends upon the position coordinates of the other electron, right? Now, so the Hamiltonian, let's say the half part of the Hamiltonian, if it operates upon this psi R1, okay, psi R1, then we will get E1 psi R1, isn't it? So when this Hamiltonian operates upon the psi R1, then we get the eigenvalue and then the eigenfunction back. Now, we know what are the solutions of this. When a hydrogen atom Hamiltonian operates upon the wave function, then we get the eigenvalue and then eigenfunction. Now, what are the solution of psi R1? Psi R1 already known to us. Well, the electron, hydrogen atom, we have one electron. That one electron actually is sitting in the 1s atomic orbit of the hydrogen atom. Therefore, we know what is the wave function for that. The wave function for the 1s atomic orbital is nothing but the square root of z cube by pi, multiplied by e^-ZR1, isn't it? Similarly, the argument we can continue for the other half of the Hamiltonian, and then the other half of the Hamiltonian precisely resembles the another hydrogen atom, and when it operates upon the sortable wave function, we get the eigenvalue, and then we get the eigenfunction back. Then what is the wave function? Well, the wave function again in this case also precisely same. The only thing that we have to change the distance R2. Okay, we have to consider only the distance electron number one, the distance between the electron number two, and then the nucleus need to be considered. Previously, the distance between the electron number one and the nucleus need to be considered. That's the only difference. Okay, so these are the solutions, and then if you take the product of these two, that is going to be the total solution of the helium atom. We are discussing a special case. The special case is that the electron-electron repulsion is neglected. If the electron-electron repulsion is neglected, the function, the wave function, it is nothing but the product of these two. Okay, now. So we can actually calculate what is the energy for the system. I mean, the energy is going to be the summation, right? It is the summation. So one hydrogen atom, when it operates upon the suitable wave function, and we are getting eigenvalue and then function back. So that is the eigenvalue. And then when the other electron, when it is operating upon suitable wave function, then we are getting eigenvalue and then function back. So when I ask you what is the total energy of the system, then you have to take the summation, and the energy is going to be this. What is that? If we have one electron, and that is nothing but minus that square by 2n square, okay? 2n square, and then minus z square by 2n square for the other electron. Therefore, and for the on the hydrogen atom, for the hydrogen atom, the electron is present in the 1s. Therefore, n has to be 1. And if you substitute n is equal to 1, the total energy is going to be minus z square. Okay, and what is z for the helium atom now? The z is 2. Therefore, 2 square is 4. Therefore, we got the answer minus 4 atomic units is the total energy of the helium atom, right? You can convert that if you like it to electron volts, and that is going to be the answer. Okay, that is going to be the answer. Now, we got the solutions of helium atom under a special circumstance. What is that? If we neglect the inter-electron repulsion, then the energy of the system is going to be 108.8 electron volt. What is the solution of the hydrogen atom? Well, it is just the product of the two 1s atomic orbitals. Okay, it is just the product of the two 1s atomic orbital is the wave function. Especially for the ground state, we are talking about for the ground state, that is the amount of energy, right? So we got the energy and then we got the wave function, that is fine. But this method, whether it is really correct or not, we have to ensure. Okay, if you look at the experimental value, well, there are ways in which you can actually do a measurement to find out the energy of the system. The ground state energy of the helium atom can be measured experimentally from the ionization potential experiments. Well, you can just knock out one electron, and you see that to knock out one electron, how much amount of the energy you are supplying. So that is the ionization potential. That potential, actually, it is measured experimentally in a laboratory, and that is actually approximately it is minus 78.62 electron volt. So that is the amount of energy. Okay, the ground state energy of the helium atom is minus 78.62. Now you can just calculate what is the error, what is the difference between the experiment and our estimate. Our estimate is that we have estimated the ground state energy of the helium atom by neglecting the electron-electron repulsion, and we got 108.8. So you can take the difference between these two and then calculate the percentage of error. It is roughly about 40%, right? It is roughly about 40%. So this clearly demonstrates that the electron-electron repulsion in the helium atom, it is really important. You can't simply neglect it. If you neglect it, then your estimate is going to be very, very crude estimate. Okay. So that's the conclusion, and the 1 over R12, that is the distance between the electron number 1 and the electron number 2, both are actually important. That 1 over R12 term is really important. You can't remove from the Hamiltonian. So that is the takeover message from this particular incident. Now we can apply the first order perturbation treatment to the helium atom, and then let us look at what exactly we get the answer. And the Hamiltonian, now we can't anyway neglect the repulsion term, so we are going to retain that repulsion term. But let me represent the Hamiltonian in a slightly different manner. Now, if you like it, the total Hamiltonian of the helium atom, you can actually take it as a two parts. One is the unperturbed system. What is that unperturbed system? Well, this total Hamiltonian, what is actually shown in the blue color, it can be taken as the unperturbed Hamiltonian. And the red color, you can take it as a perturbation. And the Hamiltonian of the perturbed system, perturbed system is what? So we are interested to find the first order correction or second order correction to the ground state energy of the helium atom, okay, as per the perturbation treatment. In this method, we need to first have the Hamiltonian. The total Hamiltonian is actually, if you like it, you can actually take the summation of an unperturbed system and perturbed Hamiltonian. And here the unperturbed Hamiltonian is minus half del 1 square minus z by r1 minus half del 2 square minus z by r2 can be taken as the perturbed unperturbed Hamiltonian. Whereas 1 over r12 can be taken as the perturbation Hamiltonian that corresponds to the perturbation. Okay, now we already know that what exactly happens if this summation, what is the summation? This unperturbed Hamiltonian, when it operates upon this wave function, the total wave function, just now we have seen the situation, it is just the product of two wave functions, psi 1s multiplied by psi 1s r1 multiplied by psi 1s r2. Okay, and what exactly those functions, those are nothing but the 1s atomic orbital of the hydrogen atom. Right, so we have seen what is capital psi r12 is nothing but the, it is the product of two hydrogen 1s atomic orbitals. Okay, so that is a quantity. So when this Hamiltonian, I mean the unperturbed Hamiltonian, when it operates, we get the corresponding energy, right? So that is the expression. Now I write this particular expression in a slightly different way, because since I am treating this particular Hamiltonian as the unperturbed thing, unperturbed Hamiltonian, now I just wanted to know, change slightly a little bit my notation. Now, when the unperturbed Hamiltonian operates upon the unperturbed wave functions, okay, then I get the eigenvalue, okay, and then I get my eigenfunction back. It is just a small notation, okay, to understand this problem in a better way, nothing else. So again, you can just expand it, what exactly these things are. Well, these things are nothing but the 1s atomic product of the 1s atomic orbitals of the hydrogen atom. Now, so the unperturbed energy, just now we have evaluated, okay, it's just a notation, I have changed it for a better clarity. Now the unperturbed system Hamiltonian, when it operates upon suitable wave function, we get the eigenvalue and then eigenfunction back. So the energy, it is going to be 108 point. There is a negative sign, so please correct it. There should be a negative sign here. So this actually is going to be minus 108.8 electron volt. Okay, but that energy is going to be very much away from the experiment. That means very much away from the reality. So we will see that what exactly happens. Now, according to the perturbation treatment, we can correct the energy. Okay, we can calculate by the first order corrections, second order corrections, the successive corrections can be calculated by using some formulas, and then you can add those correction to the actual energy. What is the actual energy? Unperturbed Hamiltonian, when it operates on the suitable wave function, we get the energy, right? Eigenvalue, that is nothing but the energy, and then function back, right? So this is the energy. This is the unperturbed system energy. This need to be corrected. That need to be corrected. Well, that we can correct it by perturbation treatment. If you recall, what is the first order correction to the energy? The first order correction to the energy, it is just nothing but the, if you recall my previous lecture, it is nothing but the this quantity. It is actually the expectation value of the ground state wave functions, involving the ground state wave functions, ground state unperturbed wave functions, involving the perturbation. right, involved in the perturbation, the Hamiltonian that correspond to the perturbation. So H1 is the Hamiltonian that correspond to the perturbation, and psi n0, those are actually unperturbed system Hamiltonian. Okay, so please recollect what we have discussed last class. If you want to evaluate the first order correction to the energy, we have shown in the last class itself, it is just nothing but the expectation value involving the Hamiltonian of the perturbation and the unperturbed wave functions. Okay, so that's the quantity we should evaluate. And please remember that we are always applying to the ground state of the system, I mean the helium atom. Now you can actually write down, and what this is going to be a double integral, as you can realize here that the wave function contain two position coordinates. Okay, two different, one is for the one electron and the other for the other electron r12. Therefore this integral, unlike the this formula, this is going to be a double integral. So r12 psi 1s 0, the 0 indicate that the unperturbed wave function, and then star indicate the complex conjugate, as you know already. And the Hamiltonian is what, for perturbation the Hamiltonian is just 1 over r12, and the wave function again I have written here. Now this wave function, you can actually keep on doing this quantity is nothing but the product of two wave functions. If you just recall it, this is just the expansion in this particular step, and these quantities, you know, you remember that these 1 over r12, it is just a product, so it doesn't do anything, it is just multiplying whatever it is there on the right hand side. Of course it is multiplication also will act as a one operator, right? So 1 over r12, just it doesn't do anything on the right hand side quantity, it's just a multiplication. So when you have AB, you can write down equivalently BA also, right? So I have just moved this quantity to the other side, and slightly we have rearranged it. Okay, why we are doing all those things? Well, the answer is quite obvious, that you can see here. So you have here on the right hand side, you have psi 1, psi 0 r1, right? And on the left hand side of this particular Hamiltonian, it is psi 0 r1. So you can combine these two things, because the psi star psi becomes psi square, right? This is also psi square, this also becomes psi square. So just combine these two terms, because the Hamiltonian is just a multiplication, you can just combine like this, and we get the integral, double integral, psi 1s square r1 multiplied by psi 1s square r2 multiplied by 1 over r12 dr1 dr2. Here the volume elements, here the volume elements are nothing but the distance, because the, remember, the hydrogen atom 1s atomic orbital doesn't contain any angular part. So therefore the integration, when you are trying to do only with regard to r, the distances you have to do, the volume is the r. Okay, and these are the quantities. Well, this particular integral actually has been solved in this particular textbook, you can just refer this. This quantity is nothing but phi by 8 z. This quantity, it is nothing but the phi by 8 z atomic units. Okay, now this is the first order correction to the energy of the system. Okay, so before perturbation we have some energy, that is minus 108.8 electron volts. So that particular thing you have to add to it for getting the helium atom energy. Okay, now already previously the energy of the system is nothing but minus z square. Of course minus z square is nothing but 4. Z is equal to 2 for helium atom, it is 4 plus 5 by 8 z, right? 5 by 8 z, and you try to just calculate what is the value for this, and then that is going to be minus 74.83 electron volt. Okay, so what is the takeover message? The takeover message is that the helium atom energy, ground state helium atom energy, if you don't incorporate the electron-electron repulsion term, the energy is going to be minus R square. Okay? And if you incorporate the electron-electron repulsion term, and then if you follow the perturbation treatment, first order correction to the perturbation, if you calculate the energy of the system, right, the correction factor is nothing but the 5/8 Z. And together, the energy is going to be minus 2.75 atomic units, which is converted to be minus 74.8 electron volt. There is a mistake here. This unit is actually electron volt. Please correct it. Okay. Now you can see what is the experimental value. You recall it. The experimental value is minus 78.62 electron volt. The difference between this estimate and the actual experiment value, you can calculate from that. You can estimate what is the percentage of error. It is calculated to be 6%. It is calculated to be 6%. Now, well, you can actually calculate the second order correction. How do you do that? Second order correction energy is minus HANL divided by some factor. So you remember the approximation method when I discussed the first order correction to the energy. Okay, it is, the expression is given already, modulus of minus sigma, minus sigma m runs from 0 to infinity and m not equal to n modulus of HMN whole squared divided by E M minus E zero. That is the energy, right? That is the energy of the second order correction. So that those integrals, if you are able to calculate, you can get the second order correction to it. That particular thing you can add to this minus 74.83. That will give you much better value, which is close to the actual experiment, right? So the process has to be continued, and the perturbation treatment actually will proceed in this particular aspect. Well, we are not going to do that. As I told you that we don't have much time to discuss all these things. Let us move on and then try to understand the variation method treatment for the helium atom. Okay, as you have seen that the first order correction has been calculated by perturbation method, and similarly the variation method, we will try to understand how variation method can be applied to the helium atom. We will try to understand and see how this is different from the perturbation treatment method. Okay, and let me recall the wave function, unperturbed system wave function is given by this, the product of the 1s atomic orbital of the hydrogen atom. Okay, those are exactly, these are the quantities. Those are nothing but the square root of z cube by pi e to the power minus zr1 in one case. And the second, for the second electron, it is again square root of z cube by pi e to the power minus zr2. The wave functions are actually those quantities. Now, if you like it, you can actually combine these two things. Then if you combine it, square root is cancelled out. Then what you get is z cube by pi multiplied by e to the power minus zr1 minus zr2 is the wave function. Okay. Now, if you look at this particular expression, you see that z, what is z? Z is the charge of the nucleus, right? Z is the charge of the nucleus. Let us imagine what exactly present in the helium atom. Helium atom, we have one nucleus and then two electrons. And these two electrons actually experiencing the total charge, that is the Z. Z is the total charge. I mean, Z multiplied by E, E is the electron charge. Of course, that is the total charge. The both the electrons are actually experiencing Z charge. So that is why this Z is actually sitting here. Okay, that is why the Z is here. But what can happen is that, you know, let's say you have the helium atom, and helium atom nucleus is here. You have one electron cloud, and then you have another electron cloud. Okay, these are actually electron. Please recall the electron is present in the 1s atomic orbital. The 1s atomic orbital is the spherical shape, right? Now, what can happen is that usually they are spherical in nature. Okay, they are spherical in nature, but sometimes it so happens that, you know, the nucleus is one, but then the electrons are so two. This particular product, it gives an impression that the both electrons are experiencing the total charge of Za. But it is, in reality, it is not so. It can be, it will be something less than what we actually expect. Why? Because sometimes the electron cloud, you know, one electron can screen the other electron. Suppose if you have a situation that I have an electron here and there is an electron actually is here, right? So this electron, which is not directly facing the nucleus, do not experience the complete nuclear charge. Okay, similarly, the reverse discussion is also possible, that this electron can present, you know, and this electron can present here. So in that case, both the electrons do not feel the complete charge of the nucleus. It will be, in reality, it will be less than what is actually supposed to be. Therefore, this particular concept is one method which is followed and which showed a good results, right? Good results to apply the variation method. Okay, so people have, you know, in the variation method, what we do first, the first step in variation method, you have to understand the system and you have to guess a trial wave function. Now I am trying to guess my trial wave function. How? I am trying to guess my wave function based on the concept of effective nuclear charge. Effective nuclear charge. What is the meaning of effective nuclear charge? In the helium atom, the wave function, if you take it, it is the product of two 1s atomic orbitals of the hydrogen atom. It gives an impression that the both electrons are experiencing the Ze total charge. But in reality, since you have two electrons, they will not actually feel the total charge, but they will feel little less than the total charge. Okay, so this particular concept is something that is used to guess the trial wave function, right? So I'm guessing my trial wave function. My trial wave function is something like this, that it doesn't, as it is not experiencing the total total charge of the nucleus, then it is experiencing something different than the Z. Therefore, that Z I consider Z prime is the effective nuclear charge that the electron is experiencing in reality. Okay. So I'm trying to guess based on the effective nuclear charge, a wave function. Okay. My actual wave function is this. But in this, the Z is the charge. This charge is experienced by the both electrons. But it is true that you can actually use your physical intuition of the system, intuition, and to guess the trial wave function. So when you have more than one electron, and you have only one nucleus, therefore, the both electrons do not feel the same nuclear charge. It will be something different. So what is that? That I don't know. I am introducing a Z prime is the effective nuclear charge. Okay. So this is the charge that actually, in reality, the electron will experience. Both the electrons will experience. Okay. Now my trial wave function is nothing but psi phi 1s r 12 is equal to z prime cube by pi e to the power minus z prime r 1 minus z prime r 2. So this is the wave function. Okay, so just to make some difference, let me also denote like this: phi 1s z prime is my trial wave function. What exactly this thing? Well, this is the quantity. Okay, so the if you see the wave function contain the charge, but the charge actually not the z, but then it is something else. That something what we are assuming it is the z prime, right? So we have guessed the trial wave function. Next thing is what we are supposed to do. Okay, what we have to evaluate what is z prime. The next thing is that we have to evaluate z prime. How do we evaluate? Well, we evaluate z prime by calculating expectation value, script e. Okay, script e is nothing but this object. Okay, integral. Okay, integral phi 1 z prime r 1 2 Hamiltonian phi 1 z prime r 1 2 d tau 1 d tau 2 divided by integral phi 1 z prime r 1 2 phi 1 z prime r 1 2 d tau d tau 2. Okay, so this is the expectation value which we have to calculate to find out z prime value. Okay, so the z prime value we can evaluate by calculating this expectation value. As you can realize that the energy, the script E is nothing but the approximate energy. It is going to be the function of z prime. It is going to be the function of z prime. Why? Because the wave function itself has the z prime, not the z, right? Therefore, it is quite obvious that the script E is going to be the function of that one. Now, we can evaluate, well, we can evaluate both the numerator and denominator, but then the denominator, you can see here that this particular object, it is the just the wave functions are already normalized. That is why you have the z prime cube by pi square root of z cube, z prime cube by pi is there, right? So that particular quantity, what we have seen, that is the normalization factor. So since already the functions are normalized, so we can say that the numerator, the denominator quantity is going to be 1. So what is the conclusion? The conclusion is that to calculate the script E or the approximate energy, we need not to evaluate the denominator. It is enough that we can actually evaluate the numerator part. So let us evaluate the numerator part, but before that, let me recall some of the eigenrelations, okay, eigenrelation which we have seen already. So the half of the Hamiltonian that correspond to the electron number 1, if it is operating upon the wave function, then we get the function back, right? We get the eigenvalue and the function back. What exactly these quantities? Well, psi r1 is this quantity. Okay, Hamiltonian is half del 1 square minus z by r1. And then this psi r1 is nothing but the 1s atomic orbital. So that is written here. Okay, and similarly, you get this on the right hand side, you get the eigenvalue. Eigenvalue here, it is nothing but minus z square by 2n square. But for the hydrogen atom, 1s, it is n is equal to 1, n square is equal to 1. Therefore, the denominator, it is becoming 2 itself. Similarly, for the other electron, the eigen relation is given by this. Okay, eigen relation is given by this. But now I am saying that the electrons are not experiencing the actual charge, that is z, but then they are experiencing something different charge. Therefore, the eigen relations are to be modified like this. Okay, so wherever you have a z, that z has to be replaced with z prime. Why? Because the electrons are not experiencing the total charge, that is z. Okay, so that is the difference between these two relations. So before considering the effective nuclear charge, we have z, but now we have z prime because we are considering nuclear charge is different for both electrons. Okay, so these are the relations actually helpful for evaluating certain integrals as we proceed further. Please remember this. So when this Hamiltonian that correspond to electron number 1, when it operates upon this wave function, we get this eigenvalue and the function back. Similarly, the electron number 2 Hamiltonian operates upon this wave function, we get the eigenvalue, that is minus z prime square by 2 eigenvalue, and then function back. So these things are important. Now let us try to evaluate the numerator part of the expectation value. I mean the approximate energy, that is script E. It is nothing but this object. Okay, please remember that as you have seen that the 1s atomic orbitals are the solutions of these hydrogen atom. Therefore, so it doesn't contain any theta part. The volume element, it becomes actually r1 and r2, dr1 and dr2. So please note that change. Okay, earlier I have used a d tau 1, but now I started using it dr1 and dr2 because the wave function doesn't contain any theta and other part. That is the reason. Okay, now we can write down the Hamiltonian. Okay, we can substitute what exactly this object and what exactly this object and what is the Hamiltonian. So you substitute those values, and this is the Hamiltonian of the helium atom, and this is the wave function. Okay, wave function in an extended version. And here, after writing, substituting the Hamiltonian and then the actual wave function, trial wave functions, what you can do, I have done a small mathematical trick which everybody knows, that I have subtracted a quantity that is minus z prime by r1, and I am adding the same quantity. Similarly, I am subtracting minus z prime by r2, and then I am adding the same quantity. So effectively this Hamiltonian doesn't change. Okay, after doing this, what I have done is this. Okay, so this is actually is the potential energy experienced by the electron number 1, right? Therefore, I can move here. Okay, so I am just trying to rearrange it. Similarly, z minus z prime by r2 is the potential energy experienced by electron number 2, and then the nucleus. So because of the nucleus and the electron number 2 interaction, we have the potential energy. See, that term you can move here, move to the kinetic energy term. So in this step, you can see here, this is the electron number 1 Hamiltonian and this is the electron number 2 Hamiltonian. Okay, so that is what it is done in the next step. Further, what we can do, you can see that you can split up. You can split up all this, you can split up the integrals and then write in a separate equations. Well, it is written that way. You can notice here that here you have, this is one term, right? So double integral dr1 dr2, double integral dr1 and dr2, this particular thing is one term, and similarly this is one term, right? And this is, you can see here again, you can rearrange slight little bit. Here you can see there is a minus z by r1, okay, minus z by r2. Okay, these two quantities you can combine here, because 1 over r1 is common, okay, from this object and this object, and from this object and this object, 1 over r2 is a common. So you can actually combine these things and finally write it to different integrals. That is what precisely done in the next step. Okay, the total integral has been splitted into respective things. Okay, so this is one Hamiltonian that correspond to electron number 1, and this is the Hamiltonian that correspond to electron number 2, and you realize that 1 over r minus z by r1 plus minus z prime by r1 is there, that you can write it here. Similarly, minus z prime by r2 plus z by r2, it is there, that also you can write it here. Now finally you have this integral, that is the repulsion, electron-electron repulsion integral. This is also there. So in the next step, what we have done is that in the previous step itself, I can explain a little bit. And here you see this, this is the Hamiltonian that correspond to electron number 1. Okay, electron number 1. So this operates upon the psi 1s z prime r1. So this wave function it operates. But then this, you see, is the electron number 2. Therefore, with regard to this Hamiltonian, this particular thing doesn't affect. Okay, therefore I can move this this side. Okay, similarly here, this is an integral, this is a Hamiltonian which actually contain the electron number 2. This will have some effect on this particular thing, but not on this. Therefore, this object, if you like it, you can move to this side. Okay, you can move to the other side. Okay, that is what I have done it. Similarly here, in the next step, and similarly here, you can actually take z prime minus z as a common factor. Z prime minus z, I think here there is a mistake, please correct it. This is z and z prime. Okay, so here also, here z prime minus z as a common factor outside, you can write down. Here also the same thing you can write outside, and remaining thing you keep it as such. I have moved the psi 1s r2 terms at one place, and remaining thing I kept it as such. Okay, here that psi 1s z prime r1, okay, and then psi 1s z prime r1, both are written here. Okay, and the next integral, what we have done, next two terms, z prime minus z is taken to be a common factor, and then inside you have that 1 over r1, let it be there itself. And then we have the two quantities, the wave function square, it is the psi star psi, so you can just take the square of it. Similarly, other wave functions like that correspond to electron number 2 also present, so you can just take the square of those functions. Okay, and then this integral is again as such it is present. Please remember that what are these exactly, these objects, psi 1s z prime. Well, the psi 1s z prime is actually of this object, but only thing is that effective nuclear charge will be present here. Psi 1s z prime r2 is this object. Okay, and this is the product. Now further simplification you can do it here. So from the first part you can from this, you know that you are doing integration with respect to dr2, and then this is electron number 2, right? It is like a psi star psi integral. Psi star psi, it is nothing but, since the functions are actually normalized, so the integral is going to be 1. And similarly, integral dr1 psi 1 is z prime star r1, psi 1 is z prime r1, actually this is again going to be 1. So that is the simplification. I have done it here, right? So, and then in the first part, as you can see here, this if it operates, and this Hamiltonian that correspond to electron number 1, if it operates upon the wave function, we get actually corresponding eigenvalue and then function back. What is eigenvalue? Eigenvalue is nothing but minus z prime square by 2. Okay, if earlier we have considered only the z, but now we are considering it is the effective nuclear charge, therefore it has to be minus z square by 2. Okay, and then wave function we will get back. Similarly, this is a Hamiltonian that corresponds to electron number 2. When it operates upon this wave function, we get the eigenvalue and then function back. So those things are actually done in the next step, and what we get is this, and what we get is minus z square by 2, and here minus z, z prime is missing here, so please note down here there has to be a z prime. Okay, and then this z prime by 2 is a constant, therefore you can move outside the integral. Similarly here, z prime square by 2 is a constant, you can move outside. Okay, so what is the integral left over? The integral what we have is that my integral dr1 psi 1 is z prime star r1 multiplied by psi 1 is z prime r1. So it is effectively, it is going to be 1. That integral is going to be 1. Similarly, here this integral is going to be 1. And here you can substitute the integrals and then try to see that this integral is going to be you can combine these two factors actually. The third and fourth term, both you can combine, and you can take the product also. And this is going to be 2 into z prime minus z, right? And then this integral. And this integral is something that we can evaluate, but anyway, I'm not going to do that. And in the last integral, what we have is that already we have done that last integral. I mean, in the previous case, when we are discussing about the perturbation treatment, that is 5/8 z prime, okay? We got actually z, but then here, the effective nuclear charge is something that we are considering. Therefore, it has to be substituted there. That's the only difference. So the script E, finally, what we get is this type of expression, where you can see that script E is z prime. Script E, which is a function of z prime, is equal to minus z prime square plus 2 z prime minus z multiplied by z prime plus 5/8 z prime. Okay, so that is the one. Now, what we should do actually, as you have seen that the energy expression, the approximate energy expression, it became the function of z prime. What is z prime? Z prime is the effective nuclear charge experienced by the electrons. And we don't know what is the z prime. And the whole purpose of doing this integration is that we have to find what is z prime. How do we find z prime? Well, the z prime can be evaluated by calculating the meaning of the quadratic equation. As you can see here, this is a quadratic equation, right? So minus z prime square plus 2z prime square minus 2z prime plus 5/8 z prime. So this is a quadratic equation. This quadratic equation will have some roots. You can just try to calculate what is the minima of this quadratic equation, right? And then from the minima, and then equate it to zero. So at the minima and the maxima, the first derivative becomes zero. That's the trick that we use it to calculate the best possible value of for z prime. Okay, the best possible value for z prime can be estimated by evaluating the first derivative of the script E z prime with regard to the z prime. So you just take the first derivative with regard to z prime. So that is what it is done here. In this particular expression, it's a quadratic equation. Then the first derivative I have evaluated, it is nothing but z prime square. It becomes, first derivative of that becomes 2z prime. And then here, 2z prime square, 2z prime square. So if you take the derivative square, it is 2z, it will come. Already 2 is there, therefore it becomes 4z prime. And minus here, 2z, z prime is there. Okay, but you are taking the derivative with regard to z prime. Therefore, it becomes minus 2z plus 5/8 plus 5/8, because the derivative, this derivative is just 1. So you can just keep the constant itself. And then the minima of this quadratic equation, we will get it only when you equate it to zero. Then you can equate this quantity to zero. Okay. Now you can evaluate what is z prime. Z prime is nothing but z minus 5/8, 5/16. Okay. What is z prime? Z prime is nothing but the 5/16. Okay. What is z actually? Z is nothing but the nuclear charge. What is the nuclear charge of the helium? Helium nuclear charge is 2. Z is 2, right? Now, initially, actually it is 2. And here, the Z prime, as you can notice here, so there is a 5/16. Okay? The Z prime is nothing but z minus 5/16. That means you are subtracting a quantity from 2. You are subtracting a quantity that is 5/16. You are subtracting. Therefore, the effective nuclear charge is reduced by a factor of, the nuclear charge of the helium atom is reduced by a factor of 5/16. In other words, one electron is screened from the nucleus by the other electron by a factor of 5/16, right? So you have two electrons. One electron is screening screening the other electron So it is not actually allowing to feel the complete nuclear charge of the nuclei, helium nuclei. So what is that factor? The factor is 5 by 16. Okay, so if you want, you can further proceed and calculate what is the script E that correspond to the best possible value. Well, this is the procedure that you have to do it to find out what is the best possible for Z prime. Now, what is the energy? What is the energy of the ground state? Well, you can substitute this particular thing in this equation to obtain the script E. Well, people have done this, so that is nothing but the minus Z minus minus Z of Z minus 5 by 16 whole square. That is nothing but this energy. If you try to evaluate, it is going to be minus 77.45 electron volt. Okay, minus 77.45 electron volt. What is the experimental value? Please recall the experimental energy for the ground state helium atom is given by minus 78.62 electron volt. And the error is roughly about 1.17 electron volt, which comes around 1.5% in terms of the error. Okay, error is only 1.5% error. So that is almost very close, right? So this is the complete solution of the helium atom by following the variation method, and previously we have seen the perturbation method. So the both approximate methods, that is the perturbation method and the variation method, they give somewhat reliable answers, reliable results, which can be interpreted with the experimental values with regard to the helium atom. Okay, so that's the conclusion for today.